Acharya does. In fact, there's a danger in it. I'll come to that. But why do people follow what Elita does? Easy path. It is certainly easy.
Hurt culture.
In fact, we are nothing but an imitating animal. A human is said to be an imitating animal, and we have that psychological truth in us. Psychology says whatever leader does, we just imitate. The hope to become a leader, because you believe, follow their footsteps, you reach the same destination. Then what's the danger in doing that? Why? If you have followed the footsteps of the leader,
you can be a level with the leader, right?
You know, especially.
You go beyond the leader.
No, we are not aspiring anything beyond, at least to get the leader level. We do not want to surpass the leader. Like, it's like, imagine, especially when you are scaling or trekking a mountain, you follow the trail which has been created by the trekkers who went ahead of you. You would not take a trail where there is not trekked, it is fresh. But still there is an element of danger there. What is the danger in following? There is a greater element of blindly following. There is no application of your own intellect. That is the reason it is all emotion. There is no intellect in that. Hey, look at him, he is doing that, you also will do that. Now, is it the right thing to do? That is not examined. You just, on emotion, you just follow what somebody has done. So, in these realms, it is at least, in fact, again, the danger I said is, in the spiritual field, what is the danger? If a master has, a spiritual master does something or does things in a particular way, it becomes a very natural for his students, his followers, disciples to emulate, follow what he does. If he does that, he wears a certain kind of clothes or he has certain mannerisms or certain lifestyle, hey, Swamiji himself is doing it, must be correct, must be right. So just do what he did. Yeah, it is blind faith as it was said, but what is the danger in following, in the, if you bring it to the spiritual field, what is the danger? You certainly do not question, because you accepted it on that sheer reverence you have for the personality, but then what is the danger in it? You will follow with the memory. Because such an influence it has had on you, you take over the tradition and just follow what has been said. Stuck to? No, we are not talking even of transcending, even he was mentioning of going beyond it, but even to reach the level where he has reached, they have reached. There is no guarantee you will get there itself. That's my question. There is no guarantee you will reach there. But what is the danger in it?
Attachment.
There is no intellect there. So the possibility is it may not be the right thing for you first and foremost. What is right for him may not be right for you.
Need not.
Need not be. Just because my guru likes Karela, that doesn't mean I must have Karela every day. He may have a liking for it. That doesn't mean I must eat. He may want to lead a particular lifestyle. How do you say it is the right thing for me? What is right for you may not be right for me, isn't it? Vice versa. Sorry, ma? Your vasanas are different. So you got to take something which is innate to your nature, not. And therefore, they say never ever follow the lifestyle of a guru. In fact, never mix the teachings and lifestyle of a Mahatma. There is a caution. In Malay, it's called Awas. So I used to, in Malaysia, whenever I used to lecture, I used to say Awas, Awas, means danger. Danger is never mix the lifestyle and the teachings of a guru. And the problem is many people are behind the personality and the lifestyle. Nobody is concerned with the teachings. Even the Sikhs, the Sikh people community, they worship the Guru Granth Sahib, Guru Nanak, Granth Sahib. But how many people follow the teachings? They are just worshipping the personality. They may worship the book. It's like worshipping the Gita. You're only worshipping the cover, but how many are following the contents? How many are imbibing the contents from it?
Get attracted to hold on to the container.
Container. So today it is all personality worship. No doubt you should bow down, revert to the personality, because that's the personality, a symbol of reverence. You can bow down, but the teachings are universal, not the personality. Because what the contradiction is, if you compare lifestyles of personalities, whom lifestyle will you follow? You are fascinated with Ramana Maharshi. Then you are a little overdressed. Fundamentally, you are not following him. I first remove the ring. I am not sure Ramana Maharshi wore that ring also. Yes, sir. So when we are far from it, what are we? Oh, I will only conveniently follow whatever I want to follow. You want to follow everything he did.
Conventions can be broken at any time.
Conveniently. Sir, if you wish to follow, can you follow everything he did?
No.
In fact, is it possible to follow all what a guru does? Even imitating wise, not in spirit. In spirit, then you have become the guru already. We are talking of imitating. If you imitate exactly what they did, is it possible to imitate everything they do? Even if you choose to imitate, whom will you choose to imitate? Who is the right guru there? Oh, my guru is the right guru? Undoubtedly. That is your emotion you are saying. On what basis you say that? On, first of all, whom do you follow? Because none of the gurus have a lifestyle which is similar. Each one had their own unique personality. Whom to follow, Tata? Whom do you follow? Please advise, we are all confused in here. Whose lifestyle to follow? Correct, you have your own lifestyle. So you can't take a lifestyle of a person and start emulating them. Therefore, since there's a danger, you don't know who to follow, what is right, you have to get to their teachings. What is the common denominator in everything which is similar is the teachings, not the personality or the lifestyle. But still it is a psychology, a mass psychology that people do what you do. But beware, there's a danger in it. Therefore, don't blindly imitate. That's the complete message if you want to ensure you don't fall a trap. Emotional wise, it's correct. When you analyze it, there's a drawback. 22. Name parthasti kartavyam trishulokeshu kimchana nanavaptamavaptavyam vartaye vacha karmani name parthasti kartavyam trishulokeshu kimchana nanavaptamavaptavyam vartaye vacha karmani. There is nothing in the three worlds, O Partha, that has to be done by me, nor is there anything unattained that should be attained by me, yet I engage in action. Who is talking? Lord Krishna himself is talking. So Krishna himself is taking himself as an example and saying, what would happen? He is already a person of liberation. And here he is saying, I am acting diligently without any attachment. For what? As a role model for others to follow so that they can rise from their sloth and lethargy. Because if I choose not to act, because there is no reason for me to act, there is nothing that I have attained, there is nothing yet to be attained. I have got everything, I have reached the highest, but still he says, I am engaging in action. What a beautiful message there, isn't it? Samapti. So here he is giving him a personal appeal. The three worlds, generally when you say three worlds, you can say the waking dream, deep sleep, you can say the physical, mental, intellectual, earth, heaven, the nether world, etc. Whatever the three worlds are, there is nothing that has to be done. So look at the responsibility of a leader.
And he knows Arjuna likes him a lot and he is Krishna. Arjuna will listen to Krishna because he is the closest friend of the philosopher.
Yeah.
If Krishna says that, then Arjuna will definitely have that appeal.
Certainly. Very true. In fact, it took 15 more chapters for Arjuna to realize. Look at that, tells how dumb Arjuna was. See, Arjuna is not considered as a spiritual seeker. Enna apdi paakringa?
Kshatriya.
He was confused. And Arjuna, see, Arjuna is not a spiritual student. He is a sentimental student. In fact, situation demanded him. It's like somebody comes to you for seeking counsel because they have a very bad relationship going on in the marriage. So they need counseling. So they come to seek some advice. Andamadri. He was a problem, he is seeking an advice. That advice is the Gita.
Thank God he was dumb. He has 700 verses.
Yeah, thanks to him. So that, and then you have the caliber of an Upanishadic student who had everything their way, they had everything, they just renounced everything and went in search of a guru for Atma Vidya. Now, these are the two extremities. And you all fall in between the two. How close are you to Arjuna or how close are you to an Upanishadic student? You got to decide for yourself. How detached are you to the world to seek the truth, or are you seeking this knowledge due to a necessity, a demand? But as he said, Arjuna is the calf. In Dhyana Shlokas we say, isn't it? Arjuna is the calf. Because the cow can be milked only in presence of the calf. So the Gita has been given in the presence of Arjuna, but it is not meant for him in that sense. It is meant for the much greater takeaway, not just what benefited Arjuna. Okay?
Yadi hyaham navarteyam jatu karmanya tandritaha mama vartmanu vartante manushya partha sarvashah yadi hyaham navarteyam jatu karmanya tandritah mama vartmanu vartante manushya partha sarvashah.
For should I not engage in action, enthusiastic men would in every way follow my path. O Partha, He is trying to put in fear into the mind of Arjuna. In case I don't engage in action, what will happen? Everyone will follow exactly what I did. And then what would happen? What would happen? Chaos, complete destruction, everything comes to a halt. See, when he says I, even though you can take the I as Krishna, or you can say the I as the pure consciousness. See, it's like electricity that is functioning all through these gadgets. It's like to ask electricity, are you getting anything from it by operating through the air conditioner? But yet with it, everything is manifesting. Different expressions are happening, but electricity has got nothing to do with it. Similarly, everything, all the laws are functioning. In fact, another name for the world is known as laws. The various laws functioning externally in the world, the macrocosmic level and the microcosmic level. So, all these laws are functioning meticulously. And what is the law which is governing all these laws? There is a law which governs all these laws that are functioning. And what is the law which governs all this law? You may perhaps call it the supreme law. Again, there is a law, no? What is that law which governs all these laws, which perhaps could be called as the supreme law, which again is being governed by the consciousness? So, consciousness is right above it, but there are laws functioning. The laws function, so there is a three tier. The laws functioning externally, internally. There is a law which governs all these laws, and there is a controller of all these laws. Three levels. Now, my question is the middle level. What is that principle or the law which governs all the laws? Take the law of gravitation. Example. What is the law, sir? Law of grace. Very gracefully the law works. Enama? It does control the entire universe. But what is that law? Is there is a law of cause and effect. Cause and effect. Correct. That's the law of gravitation. The law of causation is that which governs all the laws, and all the laws have got a cause and effect. You combine two atoms of hydrogen and an atom of oxygen to form a molecule of water. Cause, effect. It can't be that you have two atoms of hydrogen, one atom of oxygen and you get something else. Only water. Every object is attracted to the center of earth at the speed of 9.8 meters per second per second. It will not be 9.6, it will not be 9.9, it is only 9.8. How does it work? Meticulously, cause and effect. The effect is an object is drawn to earth, the cause is the law functioning. So, there is an effect. Everything has a cause and an effect. So, this is what he is saying. Why, when he says, if I do not engage in action, means if that law does not work, then all these laws will stop functioning, there will be complete chaos. Now, what we must understand is, we are taking them for granted. We do not even realize so many things are happening. By mistake, let us say some sharp object gets cuts, you get a cut on the nerve. You will bleed to death in sleep. It is not such a severe cut that you will wake up and it's such a cut that you may die out of just bleeding. But nature protects you from bleeding to death, you get clot. There's a law that's functioning there, isn't it? Any doctors here? Blood clot, coagulation. So many things that happen. It's happening meticulously. Who's governing it? Even if the tiniest speck of dust falls in your eye, your system is working to check it out of the system. How? Your eyes start watering immediately. Who is governing that? Ascharya. Isn't it a functioning? If the law is functioning, everything is being governed meticulously. So if that doesn't function, things will go berserk, things will go completely chaotic. That's what he says. So fear of the consequence of his actions, everything will come to a grinding halt. So he is planting fear.
Utsi de yurime lokam nakuryam karma chedaham sankarasya chakartasyam upahanyami mah prajaha. Utsi de yurime lokan nakuryam karma kechedaham sankarasya chakartasyam upahanyami mah prajaha.
These worlds would perish if I did not perform action. I would be the author of confusion of castes and should destroy these people. Now he is threatening him. Perhaps Arjuna started reacting to these emotions, so he continued a line of thought. That is what perhaps you could gather, because the previous two verses, what are the emotions he injected? Gayatri, any idea? 22nd verse, he took a personal appeal to him. 23rd verse, he said fear, and here he is threatening him. Things will come, complete confusion of castes. I should be the cause of confusion of castes. What are the four castes, Shiva? The four varnas. What are the four caste systems? Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. So the four caste systems, the classification of these caste systems is based on ఇది ఏంటిది ఇది అందుకని చేయి కింద పెట్టలేదు నేను ఇది ఐ హోప్ యూ డిడ్ హియర్ హర్ వాట్ డిటర్మిన్స్ ద కేపబిలిటీ వాట్ డిటర్మిన్స్ ద టాలెంట్ ఆల్ ఆఫ్ us ఫాల్ అండర్ ద ఫోర్ వర్ణస్ వాట్ ఈస్ ఇట్ దట్ డిటర్మిన్స్ విచ్ వర్ణ యూ క్వాలిఫై టు. You are performing an action because you belong to that category. My question is, what is it that classifies you into that category? Predominant characteristic. Okay, but what is it that determines how much of it is there in you? Vasanas. Sir, how can a vasana determine whether you are a brahmana or a kshatriya?
Your action.
It depends upon the physical ability of the people.
No.
It is in fact not physical, it is actually mental. So what is the mental, when you talk of mental, what are we talking about? Gunas. So what are the three gunas? Sattva, Rajas, Tamas. So it is the varnas are classified based on the three gunas. So when you qualify, any human being is classified into the varna based on the gunas. Now I belong to a business, a Vaishya community. All my cousins, all my relatives, everybody are into business as a Vaishya community. I am born into it. But from day one I was allergic to do business. You give me a capital and say run business, I will do charity with it. I will not run business. So it's nothing to do with the
word.
My nature. Now what is that qualifies me as a non-Vaishya or non, I am not, what is that? Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. A Vaishya is one who does the business, but I am allergic to it, but I am more favorable to, this is a Brahmanic culture. So what is it that has made me naturally inclined towards this and allergic to that? It is the Sattva Guna in me that has made me more inclined to this and less inclined to that. So the varnas are based on the mental temperaments, and everyone, as you rightly said, has a proportion of all three, sattva, rajas, tamas. So the sattva is more predominant in a person, and very little of rajas, tamas, you become a brahmana. The highest sattva guna is more inclined towards study, teaching, reflection, etc. But when rajas takes a precedence over sattva, then you become a Sidraman Garu,
yeah.
When Rajas takes over, what happens? When Rajas takes over Sattva, what happens? I just took an example that mind left the classroom, literally his mind has left the classroom. I understand, sir, the responsibility is there, but what happens when Rajas takes over and Sattva drops? Harijji? You are more chivalry, you want to defend a nation, fight. Arjuna was a Kshatriya. When Sattva further drops and Tamas takes over and Rajas starts falling, you become a businessman, Vaishya. And Tamas takes a precedence over Rajas and traces of Sattva, you become a Shudra. So it is meant for all classifications of people, whether you are a Westerner, whether American, whether African, whether an Aboriginal, or whether you are a Japanese, doesn't matter which, it is applicable to, even though it was very well documented, bifurcated in India, it is applicable to entire humanity, because it is based on mental temperaments. So he says, if all this caste system will go, it will complete a confusion. Because there will be chaos. Imagine a Kshatriya is doing a Brahmana's job, a Shudra is doing a Kshatriya's job, complete chaos. It doesn't happen. If he is just trying to put that, threatening him, what will happen? Rama? Yeah, you do your duty as a Kshatriya. Go and fight. Move on.
Sakta karmanya vidvamsaha yatha kurvanti bharata kuryad vidvamstatha saktaha chikirshur loka sangraham saktah karmanya vidvamsaha yatha kurvanti bharata kuryad vidvams tatha saktah chikirshur loka sangraham.
In fact, this is the most important section of the chapter. Verses 25 to 35 is the beginning of the third topic where he gives a technique of right action. In fact, the 30th verse of chapter 3 is the backbone of karma yoga. It falls in this chapter, so in this topic rather. So here he says, as an ignorant man acts attached to action, O Bharata, so should the wise one act without attachment, wishing the welfare of the world. So you have a choice. What's the choice? Either operate ignorantly with attachment or operate as a wise man with perfect detachment. If you read the Sanskrit words, Hariji, what is the Sanskrit word for ignorant? Any idea? Anyone? No, he doesn't say the word muda in the verse. Muda also is ignorant, is a fool rather. Muda is a fool. Here ignorance he says. So what is the Sanskrit word? Avidvamsaha. Avidvan illa. Avidvamsaha. That is a plural. And he says vidvan. He doesn't say vidvamsaha. Vidvan singular. Enduk sarala? Grammatical vidwan, wise he says in singular, ignorant avidvamsaha in plural. Why ala endukala antnaru? Any idea? Majority of people are ignorant, are fools. Therefore, he grammatical only uses a plural sense, and vidwan he says a rare one is wise, singular sense. See, the can you look into the grammar, the choice of words, what implication lies apart from the philosophical implication, the grammar also has implication. Mind boggling. It's amazing. Oh Bharata, Arjuna, so how do you describe an ignorant action first? Because he says an ignorant, as an ignorant act attached to action. Explain that. I am only asking, how do you explain an ignorant action?
Action with attachment.
What do you mean proper application?
To take an action without any study of it, do random.
Just jump into it without, okay.
It's an ignorant action.
Any further?
The ignorant attached to the action.
She said that. What else will qualify as ignorant action? Without discrimination. Attachment is not bondage. An action with a selfish motive, self-centered motive, anything which doesn't have a welfare of others, your actions are of ignorant nature. No loka sangraha. Loka sangraha means welfare of the world. So an ignorant person, actions are driven on selfish desires, personal motives, full of attachment and emotion. Such a person is ignorant. He says, clearly is mentioning, Just like that fellow acts helplessly attached, you also act helplessly detached. Let that be your trait, let that be your swabhava, let that be your flavor, that work for the welfare of others. Sir, is it possible for a selfish person to think unselfishly?
No.
Same way, it becomes almost impossible for an unselfish person to think selfishly. Impossible. It's like, Swamiji used to give an example, a relative of theirs used to come to borrow money from his father. $0.30 or okay, like 2 rupees, 2 rupees venu. Edukada 2 rupees, movie paakanum, I need to go to the movie, so I need 2 rupees. But you don't want to simply give because he asked. But movie only 1 rupee da na. Ticket only 1 rupee, why you need 2 rupees? No, me and my friend are going. Nanu and friend pora, adukaga 2 rupees venu. So even when you're borrowing for your friend, an unselfish spirit is there in that. That's what I'm saying. You're not borrowing for yourself, you're borrowing for your friend also. The unselfish spirit comes in it. Yajna there. But you will be in trouble, not your friend. Helplessly, you can't but think unselfishly. So sweet. The thought is so sweet, so genuine. You understand? So, therefore, he says, keep performing action. Arjuna, just like the ignorant act, so should the wise one act with as much enthusiasm as a selfish person. Be as enthusiastic, but only difference is just increase your circle of identification, not just for yourself, just for a larger circle, for a greater purpose. All that. Carry on. Selfish, selfish motive. Unselfish, unselfish motive. Selfless is no motive. Adu romba kashtam adu. A little long way to go. But at least we can make. How to get to selfless?
For larger cause.
How do you move from unselfish to selfless? I'm concluding soon, almost done. Selfless and no motive. అంటే మోటివే లేదుమా. యు నో మోటివ్ అర్థమవుతుంది కదా. సెల్ఫిష్ అంటే మోటివ్ అంటే ఫర్ యువర్ సెల్ఫ్, మన కోసం, నా కోసం. అన్సెల్ఫిష్ అంటే మన కోసం. ఐఎమ్ ఫైటింగ్ ఫర్ ఎవ్రీబడీ సేక్, నాట్ జస్ట్ ఫర్ మై సేక్. అండర్స్టాండ్? సెల్ఫ్లెస్ అంటే మోటివే లేదు. దేర్ ఇస్ నో ఇంటెన్షన్ అట్ ఆల్. యూ డూ ఓన్లీ ఫర్ ద సేక్ ఆఫ్ రియలైజేషన్. సో హౌ టు రీచ్ ఫ్రమ్ అన్సెల్ఫిష్ టు సెల్ఫ్లెస్? What do you need to do? Okay, the same thing you did from selfish to unselfish. What you did from selfish to unselfish? Ama, but what you did to the motive? Enama? Correct. But what happened to the motive? Unattached. You know. என்ன பண்ணீங்க மோட்டிவ்? என்ன பண்ணீங்க நீங்க? நோ நோ, ஐ ட்ரை டு, யூ ட்ரை டு ஆன்சர் வித் த வேர்ட் மோட்டிவ், தென் யூ வில் கெட் டு ஹியர் ஆல்சோ. ஆஸ் ஐ செட், வாட் யூ டிட் டு மோட்டிவ் ஃப்ரம் செல்ஃபிஷ் டு அன்செல்ஃபிஷ், த சேம் திங் யூ காட் டு டூ ஃப்ரம் அன்செல்ஃபிஷ் டு செல்ஃப்லெஸ். இட் வில் பி டிஃபிகல்ட் டு, வெரி சாரி. I'm trying to you to read my words, you see, my mind. See, what you have done from selfish to unselfish, have you not gone about purifying the motive? When your motive becomes impure, it is unselfish. It becomes purer, it becomes You're refining the motive, isn't it? It going through the purification process. When you purify the process of a selfish motive, it becomes more unselfish. Now, how to move from unselfish to selfless? Same process continue. Keep purifying it to an extent where there is no self. So the word ultimately worked. The self is not there in the motive, then becomes selfless. Because unselfish also is only selfish from a higher point of view. It's only degree. Oh, I am 40% unselfish and 60% you are selfish. So keep that changing, slowly you will get to selfless one day. Although just purifying. That's how they say it works. Okay.
Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate.